Thank you. now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. I will refresh the weary soul, and I will satisfy every anguishing and sorrowful person. The Apostolic Church North America, Texas presents Refreshing Time every Sunday at 6 p.m. on ABN Television, a program where the fresh anointing oil of God shall be released unto the weary, and all that you fret for shall disappear. Come stand on the promises of God at the Refreshing Time with the Apostolic Church North America, Texas, 14706 Lineter Drive, Houston, Texas, 77083. Get refreshed. Jesus is Lord.
Upon this boundless ocean, upon life's boundless ocean, upon life's boundless ocean.
Upon life's boundless ocean, where my day billows roll, I fix my hope in Jesus, blessed and God of my soul. When trials assail me, that's all I can require. I rest upon His mercy and trust.
When a poor woman is married to a rich man, she's a rich person. When a farmer is married to a prince, she becomes a queen. Today the Lord is taking you to a higher place. Today the Lord is raising you up. And as you are standing, just raise up your hand and say, Lord, I put my hand into your hand. Pull me up to a higher level. Can you turn that to praise? Yes, Lord. I put my hands into your hands. Father, pull me up. Pull me up to you. Take me to a higher level. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. You can sit like a prince and a princess. Today, by the grace of God, we are going into the scriptures. And this message is titled, The Believer's Two Functions. The Believer's Two Functions. Come with me to the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 1 and verse 6. And have made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. It is the will of God for you to share in his glory. It is the will of God for you to have dominion power, to exercise dominion. And God will achieve that purpose in your life today in Jesus' name. Yeah. As a believer, we are not only redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, we are saved to be God's witnesses and worshipers. You are saved by the blood of Jesus shed on the cross. Your sins are taken away. God has been appeased because of the blood of Jesus. God is no longer angry with you. And because of this, God has assigned two roles to you in his kingdom. He wants you to be his witness, and he wants you to be his worshiper. Come with me to the book of Isaiah, We want to see David as an example of that high exaltation. Isaiah chapter 55, verses 4 and 5. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and commander to the people. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee because of the Lord thy God, and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. The Bible made it clear that when God called David from the bush, he brought him to the throne. And this is a picture of what God is doing in your life as a believer. You are saved. You are regenerated. You are redeemed. Not to be left in the valley of despondency, but to be lifted to a place of honor and glory as long as God remains your God. That was what God revealed to John on the island of Patmos. He was on that island as a castaway. He was on that island to languish. He was on that island to die, but God gave him life. God made him to understand that the situation he found himself now is not permanent. And I want you to understand, as a true child of God, whatever has been happening to you before you come to this service this morning, whatever you have been experiencing, there is going to be a turnaround.
Amen.
This man was on the island of Patmos for the word of God. And God revealed many things to him. Things that were past, things that are present, and things that are for the future. Why? Because God has revealed to him that as a believer, you are a priest and you are a king to God. That is why this morning, I want you to see yourself in a new way. I want you to see yourself as God sees you. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, the Bible tells me who I am as a believer. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That is the purpose of God for you, to witness and to worship, to perform the function of a priest and a king. That is what God has designed you for when you are saved. That is what Jesus Christ wants to share with you. He wants to share his priestly office and kingly office with you. And I believe you are ready for that honor this morning.
Amen.
These dual offices positioned all genuine believers at vantage point over Satan and his agents. When you say you are a Christian and you are in Christ, the Bible says you are seated with Christ in heavenly places, far above all principalities and powers. Now, let's go back home to Africa. In the olden days, two people are indispensable in a community. Two people are indispensable in a tribe. Who are these two people, the priest and the king. No African society can survive without any of these two. They need a priest who will stand between them and their idol to tell them what to do when things are difficult. They need somebody who understands the language of their idols to speak to them. And they need somebody who will be their head. That is why back home in Africa, we see king as next to God. Alashe Ikeji Orisha. But they did it ignorantly. But Jesus, through his blood that was shed on the cross, which means he gave his life for my own life. He gave his life for your own life. Jesus now, by that singular act, which cannot be duplicated, which cannot be repeated by anybody, has promoted me. He has promoted you to a level the Bible calls you are higher than Satan, higher than the principalities, higher than powers. Back home in Africa, when a king is enthroned, everybody will come to pay obeisance. Everybody in that city, whether you are witches, whether you are wizards, whether you are thieves, whoever in that society, they will come and do obeisance to him, and they will introduce themselves. That is why if a society is peaceful, it depends on the quality of the king. So, as a believer, the Bible said, as Christ is, so you are. I want you to open to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 17. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. What does that mean? As Jesus is, so I am. Does that make me Jesus? No. But I am a regent of Jesus. He has delegated his power. Jesus did not go to heaven with the power of the Holy Spirit. They don't need it in heaven. He left it for me. He left it for you. That's why he said, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. You shall be my regent. I have delegated the authority to you. When I was in the world, I was ruling. I leave the world now. You are in the world as rulers. When I was in the world, I was your priest, and I'm going to heaven. But now, I have transferred the office of that priesthood to you. So, who is a king? A king is a ruler of a city or an empire. He controls the military, he controls the economy, and functions as a spiritual leader. That's a king. Everything going on in that community, everything going on in that city must be sanctioned by the king. In other words, when you say, I am a Christian, God is putting you in charge. God is putting you in control. God is asking you, I have delegated this authority to you. Use it in my name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is God's agent. among his people. And as a king, he must be honored. It is not a question of he should be honored or he may be honored. A king must be honored. According to the Bible, in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 17, we read, honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. The devil says, the day you gave your life to the Lord Jesus and you are sealed with the Holy Spirit and you are committed to the King of Kings, you are now a king under the King of Kings. You are a king. I am a king. You are not a slave. You are not a servant to the world. No. You are to exercise authority. That is what a king does. A king rules. A king reigns. That is why you need to know that believers are God's kings on earth to exercise his authority and power over the earth. Jesus gathered his disciples together and he sent them out. Let us hear what he told them. In Luke chapter 10, verse 17 to 19, he said, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Back home in Africa, you know what they do for a king? When a king is enthroned, everybody comes to fortify him because he is the federal head of that tribe. He is the federal head of that community. Whatever happens to him affects the community. So the first thing they do for a king is to fortify him. They will make him strong. They will make him the strongest person in the community. They contribute. Those who are elderly, they will initiate him. They will do many things to make him power above everybody. Much more as God planned for you. The plan of God for you is to empower you above Satan and every power in the world. That is the reason why you can say, I am a Christian. Because the power that Jesus Christ had is the same power that you have. If you are diligent, if you are in Christ, if you are not deceiving yourself, a king, that is who you are. They carry his anointing. Believers are full of the power of Jesus. I want you to pay special attention to what I'm going to read to you now. Because I have listened to many people, they misunderstood coming to church. They understood coming to Christ. They don't even understand what regeneration is all about. Regeneration is a change of your nature. After you have been justified, you now have the power to carry the nature of God in you. You have the gen of God in you. You have the authority of God in you. That's what it means. But the problem with many people is that they are not willing to go all out for God. They are not totally surrendering whatever they have. They are returning some properties of the devil in their hands, and those properties are tying them to the devil. My father was preaching one day. Then he said, those of you who are claiming to be Christians, and you still go to seek for help from the herbalist, you bury something in your shirt, you hang something under your roof to protect yourself. He said, you are making things easier for the devil. Oh, yes. If you are passing now in front of the house of somebody who is your friend, but you didn't know, you are just walking on the street, and he happened to peep and see you passing, he said, Mr. So-so, so you used to come to our area. What? Who is that? So, you are living here? Oh my God. What do? You enter, right? You share your fellowship with such a person. And if you are a responsible somebody, right? By the time you are going, you are not going to go empty-handed, right? The children in the house, oh, you children, come, let me give you something. Yeah, come, take. The same thing. When you harbor anything of the devil, right? Whether in your shop or in your home or in your body, any demon passing by, the one in your body, the one in your shop, the one in your house will say, hello, don't you know I'm here? And the demon will say, I did not know. So you are living here? Oh, fine. And he will come. And you know what? By the time that demon will be going, the demon also will give gifts to your children. He will touch your business. He will touch your house. And believe me, you cannot give what you don't have. The devil doesn't have peace. So there is no way he can give you peace. He's going to give you trouble because that's what he had. Only God had life. Only God had peace. That is why when you accommodate God in your life, when you accept him into your life, he blesses you because he cannot do otherwise. That's what he has. You need to understand that. When you say, I am a Christian, and God is in you, you become accessible. Every blessing of God is accessible to you. It's just like a poor girl, a village girl, got married to the king of a town. What happens to her status? Everything will change. Everything will change. The girl will just discover that now she has bodyguards. Right? Oh, I want to go to market and buy something. Market? You can do that. Somebody will do it for you. You are now a queen. A king. The Bible said, as Jesus Christ is, so we are. But if you are to be who Jesus Christ is, then the real Jesus must be in you. There must not be deceit. See, so in Isaiah chapter 45, I want to read these five verses. Thus said the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have holding, to subdue nations before him. You see that? And I will loose the loins of kings, to open before him the two-leaved gate, and the gate shall not be shut. I will go before thee, and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of brass, and cut in sunder the bars of iron. And I will give thee the treasures of darkness, and the hidden riches of secret places, that thou mayest know that I, the Lord, which call thee by thy name, I am the God of Israel. for Jacob my servant's sake, and Israel my elect, I have even called thee by thy name. I have surnamed thee, though thou hast not known me. I am the Lord, and there is none else. There is no God beside me. I gather thee, though thou hast not known me. The picture of a believer here. I remembered when I was in Cote d'Ivoire. I was preaching to a man, very, very strong in the powers of darkness. Do you know how God arrested him? He came to worship with us. And we were in prayer session. The power of the Lord came down. And you know what? Every power on his body was destroyed. God did not stop at that. So, we did not see this man in the church anymore. So one day, one of our members met him and said, "Baba, we did not see you in church." He said, "Which church?" He said, "The New Market." "The church?" He said, "No. No way." He said, "What happened?" He said, "You know what? The day I entered that church, all the powers I had on me was destroyed. And to add insult to injury, your pastor that day, as he was praying, he said, even all your powers at home, in the name of Jesus, they are destroyed." He said, he entered his house, his demons no longer respond to him. Are you listening? That is who you are. You carry authority as a believer. You carry authority as a Christian, unless you are deceiving yourself. You are a king. A king rules and reigns. So are believers in Christ. You are to rule. You are to reign as a believer. You are not a jellyfish. You are not to be fearful. You are not to be feverish. You are to stand your ground and say, "Here I stand in the name of Jesus." And the Bible said the Lord will put Satan underneath your feet. Why? Because you are a king under the King of Kings. Who is a priest? Priesthood is something known in every culture and religion. A priest represents people before God by offering sacrifice to appease God for their sins and offer prayers on their behalf to God. That is a priest. He stands to represent God to man. He takes from man to God their burdens, their problems, their sorrows, their attacks. He takes them to God in prayer. Do you know why many of you are not enjoying your Christian life? It is because you do not want to become a priest. You don't want to carry the burdens of other people to God. You don't want to interfere between other people and God. You are so selfish about yourself. You are so selfish about that which concerns you. And that is why you are not enjoying the privilege of being a Christian. The day you decide, by the grace of God and by the power of the Holy Spirit in you, to start interceding for people, that day you begin to enjoy Jesus Christ more. What is Jesus Christ doing in heaven now? He's interceding for me. Is interceding for you. That is why God cannot joke with the matter of Jesus. That is why whatever Jesus Christ demanded from God, God will do it, because he knew he was not asking it for himself. He was asking it for other people, for the glory of God. The moment you begin to look for your personal glory, God will fold his hands and be looking at you. Because you are selfish. Because you are just concerned about your matter, my own. How many of you are willing to share the money you are earning with God and man? And let me tell you, when you refuse to share your money with God and man, that money will go down the doldrums. It will go down the drains. Because money spent for God and man is an investment which will come back to you. When you pray for the church of God and you pray for other people, it is an investment. That prayer is coming back to you. When you stand in the gap for other people, for their liberation, for their promotion, God is going to raise people to stand in the gap for you also. But when your prayer is based on me, and then God will be looking at you. Because you are not a priest. A priest stands for the people. He stands for the people. He carries the bodies of the people to God. The Bible says, the mockery of those who mock thee fell on me. That's a priest. So, Jesus Christ is our great high priest, who offered himself as a ransom for our sins. That is what atonement is all about. Jesus offered himself. Very soon, we will enter into Lent. I think we are already in Lent. Huh? Okay? You will see people trying to reduplicate what Jesus has done. But listen to me. It should not be a seasonal thing. It should be what a Christian should be doing 24/7. If it is only in April that you remember the suffering of Jesus in your life, then something is wrong with your Christianity. Because all around you, there are people who are still languishing in sin, languishing in sickness, languishing in evil. Who is going to intercede on their behalf? It is you. And when you do that, you become a priest to God. Believers are priests to God to offer sacrifice of praises unto God. You know, the happiest people on earth are soul winners. When you see people for whom God has used you, people who should have been destroyed by the devil, and they are bouncing in the Lord, you have the greatest joy. So, how can you function in the two offices of king and priest? And I want you to note the order. Jesus first made us kings and what? Priests. Why? Because you cannot give what you don't have. If you don't have authority, you cannot give authority. If you don't have power, you cannot liberate others. That is why the matter of the Holy Ghost is very, very important in your life. My brothers and sisters, forget everything you are looking for in the world. Base your prayers on the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Because when you are in authority, everything will be at your beck and call. When authority speaks, there must be action. That is why you need the Holy Spirit in your life. So, how can you function in these two offices of king and priest? Every king carries a scepter, which is the symbol of his office. Every king has a scepter. That is the symbol of the office. The same thing. Every believer carries a scepter of authority received from Jesus. In the book of Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 to 14, it reads, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin. What does that mean? The center is the righteousness of Jesus imputed to you as a redeemed soul. The center that signifies your authority is the righteousness of Jesus. As I am now, right? If the president sees me and said, please, arraign him, and they put on the garment of an army general or me, right? I'm a preacher. But he asked that I should be decorated. And they put on the garment of an army general or me, right? If I move out and I'm walking, any soldier that meets me, what will he do? Huh? Why? Why? Because of what I'm wearing. He doesn't need to know who I am. No? The moment he sees me in that dress, yes, yes sir, whether I know how to reply or not. That is it. When Jesus puts his righteousness upon you, you become respectable. Sin has made you rejectable. But when the righteousness of Jesus comes upon you, you become acceptable to God. You carry that center anywhere you go. Two. Every king and priest carries anointing, which separates him unto God. When you say a priest, when you say a king, they have one thing in common. The two of them must be anointed. A king that is not anointed is not a king. He's a king in waiting. A priest that is not anointed is not a priest. He cannot function. The same thing, before you can function in the office of king and prophet, you must be anointed. The anointing separates the king. You see, before his anointing, he was ordinary man. But the very minute the oil was poured upon him, even when his father sees him, he will do what? He will do obeisance. Why? Because of the anointing. The same thing a priest. The two of them carries anointing. The same thing. See? This anointing is the Holy Spirit in you. In 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 13, then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose and went to Ramah. You see that? The very day the anointing oil was put upon David, he was separated. And David was number 7, the last one. But from the day the oil of God was put upon him, he was separated from his brothers. He became taller, higher than them. When you carry the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you are higher than the highest in the world. But if you don't have the anointing, you just remain a floor member. When you have the Holy Spirit of God in you, you are higher than the highest and taller than the tallest. You carry the anointing. Every king and priest is separated from other human beings. Every believer must be holy as him who has called his holy. The two of them, priest and king, they must be holy. When Saul lost his holiness, he lost his kingdom. When Eli lost his holiness, he lost the priesthood. Listen to me. Don't let anybody deceive you that you can continue in sin and expect the grace of God to multiply in your life. No. The two cannot go together. Light and darkness. Holy and unholy. They cannot. It is either you are holy and you are for God, or you are not holy and you are not for Him. I know somebody will say, yeah, but God came for sinners. Yes, so that sinners will not remain sinners. That's it. You think Jesus Christ died for you? He died for your sins so that you can still remain a sinner? No. He came so that sinners will not remain sinners but turn to saints. And the word saints mean holy people. It is important that you understand this. The Bible said in 1 Peter chapter 1, 15 to 16, it said, as he who has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Many of you, you think it is only when you are in the church that you should be holy. That's a lie. You are to be holy in every area of your life. You have to be holy in your business. You have to be holy everywhere, because Mr. Death can meet you at anywhere. You have to. So, every king and priest has a jurisdiction or sphere or area or kingdom where he functions. The same thing, every believer must function in the church using the power and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. If you say you are a Christian and you don't have the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the fruits of the Holy Spirit are not manifesting in you, something is wrong. When you have the gifts of the Holy Spirit, you are given an assignment. You are given implements to do it. Right? But you need the fruit of the Holy Spirit in life to build relationships. You see, when you have the power of the Holy Spirit, yes, it breaks ground for you. But the fruit of the Holy Spirit, in addition to the power of the Holy Spirit, gives you good relationship with people. And you know what? The reason why Jesus Christ came was not to start a religion, but to give a relationship, to maintain a relationship between God and man, which sin has broken. So when you talk about a priest and a king, the two of them, they are charged with maintaining good, virile, and powerful relationship. The priest sees to it that your relationship with God is cordial. The king sees to it that your relationship with other people are legal and cordial. That is why a king will punish offenders. A king will punish those who misbehave, because they are breaking relationship. They are not making relationship popular and admirable. And because of that, the community is being polluted. So, when the Bible says you are priests and kings to God, you are now seeing that you are a relationship builder.
you are to demonstrate the love of God to other people so that they can see the difference in you and come to God through you. You are a priest. You are a king unto God. You are not created or redeemed to be dominated by Satan, sin, and the world. No. To the contrary, you as a king and priest are expected to exercise the resurrection power of Jesus here on earth. There are many people, they think, God wants them to be holy when they get to heaven. There is no need for holiness in heaven because there is no sin in heaven. It is here in the world that you must be holy. It is here in the world that I must prove myself as a Christian. It is here that you must prove yourself as a Christian. In Acts of the Apostles, chapters 4, verse 33, the Bible said, with great power, the apostles gave witness of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and great grace was upon them all. You see the two? Authority and influence. Authority and influence. When you demonstrate divine authority, God wants your life to influence others for Him. When your life is not influencing people for Him, every investment God has made into you is a wastage. That's what you get in Romans chapter 6, 12 to 14. The Bible said, sin shall not have dominion over you. Sin shall not control you. Sin shall not dominate you. How many of you are still slaves to sin? How many of you are still slaves to anger? How many of you are still slaves to deceit in your life? People cannot take your yes for a yes. People are not comfortable when they are dealing with you, because you keep on shifting the goalpost. You cannot be attached. You cannot be identified with Christ. That's horrible. So, know who you are and exercise your right to rule and reign with Christ, not in heaven, but on earth. Come with me to Romans chapter 5. As I humbly request you to please stand up and we read together. The book of Romans chapter 5. Let us humbly read verses 17 and 18 together. Are we there? You can look at the screen. Go. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. 18. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification. Can you bow down your heads? God, make me a king and a priest today.
Okay, family, no say, they be the guy.